Welcome to School of Bible Believers, Lesson 9B, B as in Bible. Lesson 9 is all about God's master plan. And last time we covered how we wanted to look at verses and see that when God made the heaven and the earth, He knew exactly what would happen. He knew man would fall, that Satan's rebellion, and because He knew what would happen, His whole plan was based upon that. His plan to die on for Jesus to die on a cross. He already had that figured out before He even created heaven and earth and all those things. So we went over that last time. And so now we want to look at Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth." So now we're going to look at the heaven. And after we finish the heaven, we're going to look at the earth. Now, Genesis 1:2 says, "And the earth." So we're told from Genesis 1:1, God created the heaven and the earth. But then the next verse, God focuses on the earth. So in order for us to talk about heaven, since He created that first, we're going to talk about it first. We've got to look at other scripture. There are details about the heaven that He created in the Bible, but they're not in Genesis 1. So first thing I wanted to do is just basically talk about what's in heaven. I put on your outline, the heaven consists of God. I didn't write the reference, but a good reference for that would be Matthew 6. Matthew 6. I'm going to write it on my outline here. Matthew 6, 9. "After this manner, therefore, pray ye, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." So heaven has God in it. God is in heaven. He will be on the earth and ruling there forever when God sets up His kingdom. But right now, He is in heaven. So, "Our Father, which art in heaven." So heaven consists of God. He also created, I wrote on your outline, He created seraphim, cherubim, and angels. Those are the three, at least what we see in Scripture that's mentioned to us. Those are the three. He didn't create man and put man in heaven. He did that on earth. But in heaven, He created spirit creatures, and the creatures that He's identified are seraphim, cherubim, and angels. Now, there are references to be the four living creatures in the book of Revelation. They're also called the four beasts, but they are actually cherubim. So let's look at these different things He created. The seraphim, Isaiah 6. I think the word seraphim is only found in your Bible maybe three times, and the description is only given here in Isaiah 6. Verse 1, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne." So there's God in heaven. "High and lifted up, and His train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain He covered His face, and with twain He covered His feet, and with twain He did fly." So the heaven consists of God, also consists of seraphim. They have six wings. Two cover their face, two cover their feet, and then they use two in the middle of their body to fly. Then the next thing He also created cherubim. Cherubim have four wings and four faces. That's over in Ezekiel chapter 10. I'm just trying to, you know, give you a picture what heaven looks like. It's important because angels, everybody thinks of angels as having wings. But you never see in the Bible angels with wings. You see seraphim have six wings and cherubim have four wings. Angels are never said to have wings. They can fly, but we're never told they have wings. Cherubim have four wings and four faces. Ezekiel 10, verse 20. "This is the living creature." Remember I said sometimes you'll see four living creatures, but they are really cherubim. Here's where you get the explanation. "This is the living creature that I saw under the God of Israel by the river of Chebar, and I knew that they were cherubims. Each one had four faces apiece, and every one four wings. And the likeness of the hands of a man was under their wings. And the likeness of their faces was the same faces which I saw by the river of Chebar. Their appearances in themselves, they went every one straight forward. So cherubims have four faces. They have four wings. By the way, the four faces, if you go over to Ezekiel 1, the four faces line up with the four characteristics of Jesus Christ the Messiah. That's the reason there are four Gospels. Jesus Christ has four characteristics that he had to fulfill, and each one of the Gospels concentrates on one of them. Okay, so in Ezekiel 1, the cherubim are described again there, but what their four faces look like are given. If you look in verse 9, Ezekiel 1:9, their wings were joined one to another. They turned not when they went. They went everyone straight forward. As for the likeness of their faces, they four had the face of a man and the face of a lion on the right side, and they four had the face of an ox on the left side. They four also had the face of an eagle. So the face of a man, we're told the lion is on the right side and the ox is on the left side. I would assume the face of a man is in the front and the face of an eagle is in the back. It doesn't say, but that seems logical. The face of a man there represents the Gospel of Luke and how Jesus was the perfect man. The face of a lion. Lion is known as the king of the jungle. And Jesus Christ was the lion of the tribe of Judah. He was Israel's king. And that's shown in Matthew. The four had the face of an ox. The ox there is the servant, beast of burden. So that would be what Mark shows Jesus as, the perfect servant. The face of an eagle represents God. And that would be what John shows, Jesus as God. So they've got those four faces. Yes?
I hope this doesn't throw you off, but can we go back to Ezekiel 10?
Okay.
Verse, let's see. Verse 21, Ezekiel 10:21.
Okay.
Where it states, I'll read the whole verse. Everyone had four faces apiece, and everyone four wings, and the likeness of the hands of a man was underneath their wings. So, is it saying that they had hands underneath their wings? Or was it more the likeness of hands being, was it God's hands underneath their wings? I'm confused.
No, I think what you said at first is correct. The likeness of the hands of a man was under their wings. So it would be they had things that looked like hands.
Under their wings.
It says likeness because they're spirit creatures. They don't have bodies like man does. God created man in his own image. And so men have bodies, and these are spirit creatures. And so they have things that look like hands of a man, but because they're not, because they're spirit creatures, it says they're like them. So it'd be hands of a man under their wings. Yeah.
Okay.
I would assume they just have two hands. Doesn't tell you, but if it's the likeness of the hands of a man and a man has two hands, it would be probably two hands under their wings. And they probably function like hands. But it doesn't really go into detail what they use those for, so I'm not sure. But yeah, those would be actual things that look like hands under their wings, and probably two. If it's like the hands of a man, since man has two hands. Okay. Okay, while Lana looks up something else, we're going to look at the next thing is the heaven also consists of angels. And angels are spirits who look like men. If you look in Genesis chapter 19, the reason I picked this is that God sends two angels to Sodom and Gomorrah to look it over and to bring judgment. And we're going to see that the angels, so in Genesis 19:1, it says, "And there came two angels to Sodom at even, and Lot sat in the gate of Sodom, and Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them, and he bowed himself with his face toward the ground." So you see that two angels come to Sodom, okay? And then, later on, verse 4, "But before they lay down," in other words, before those angels, Lot invites them in, they come into Lot's house, "and before those angels lay down, the men of the city, even the men of Sodom, compassed the house round, both old and young, all the people from every quarter. And they called unto Lot and said unto him, Where are the men which came into thee this night? Bring them out unto us, that we may know them." So verse 1 identifies them as angels. But the unbelievers of Sodom and Gomorrah say, "Where are the men which came out?" So it would make you think then that men, that angels look like men, basically. Did you have something?
No, I thought I did, but I don't. Oh, okay. So basically, angels do not have wings.
Right, right.
So every little trinket that you see women have, that's usually a woman with these two wings, but they're, you know, they're supposedly really beautiful little trinkets, you know, little knick-knack kind of things, and it's always a beautiful woman with long blonde hair or long brown, well, very few with long brown hair, but a beautiful dress and two wings. That is not an angel.
Right. Usually they're considered women with wings. In the Bible, you never see an angel described as having wings, and they are all men. I mean, they're not men because they don't have physical bodies. They're angels. They're not men, but they look like men. They're called, the only two angels mentioned by name in the Bible, other than Jesus, angel of the Lord, would be Gabriel and Michael. Both of them are described in the masculine gender, he. So they are not feminine. There are no angels that are called she. There are no angels like that. You never see them with wings. And the point I was making in Genesis 19, if there are two angels that come, and they are he, so they are men, but yet the men of the city say, "Where are the men?" It shows you that angels look like men. There's also another scripture. I probably can't find it offhand, but there's a scripture where in Revelation, where you've got the city being measured. And it mentions, maybe it's Revelation 11. I know in Ezekiel they measure the city as well, but I don't think it's, it doesn't have the reference that I'm looking for. But basically, there's a reference in the book of Revelation where the city is measured, the city of Jerusalem, the New Jerusalem. And in that measurement, you have, it's basically 1,500 miles four square, which turns out to be 12,000 furlongs in that scripture. And when you have the measurement, it specifically identifies that angel who measured. Okay, here it is. Revelation 21. Verse 16. And the city lieth four square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs. The length and the breadth and the height of it are all equal. And he measured the wall thereof 144 cubits, according to the measure of a man that is of the angel. So you can see how the man and the angel are linked there. The measure, the angel is the one measuring it, but yet it's the measure of a man. It's according unto the measure of a man, that is, of the angel. So it's not some, I mean, the angel is a spirit creature. Look over in the next verse we're going to cover, Psalm 104. Psalm 104 and verse 4. This is interesting because this is actually has to do with the creation. If you look in verse 2, who covereth thyself, that's God covering himself with light as with a garment, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain. So there he's creating the heavens. Who layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters, that's the creation of the earth there. Who maketh the clouds his chariot, who walketh upon the wings of the wind, who maketh his angels spirits, his ministers a flaming fire. So the angels are spirits. They're not made in the image of God. They can take on the form of a man, like we saw in Genesis 19. They look like men to the people in Sodom and Gomorrah. But they're just spirit creatures who look like men. And so when they come down, since they are ministers, it says his minister is a flaming fire. They are ministers of God. And so there are times when angels come to interact with men and they are in bodily form. So they look like men. Another example, if you look over in Matthew 28 at the resurrection, you can see what he looks like. Matthew 28, verse 1. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. Verse 2. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. Well, if all you are a spirit, if you don't have a body, you can't move a stone. I mean, you may have the strength to do it, but you don't have physical hands to take hold of a physical stone and move it. You also cannot sit upon a stone. If you're just a spirit being that's, you know, you think of like Casper the Friendly Ghost. You know, he could go through a wall because he's just a spirit. He goes through there, but he couldn't actually take a stone and move it away. He couldn't actually sit on a stone because he's a spirit. So that's what angels are. But yet, since they're ministers of God, sometimes they take on, and they're considered, they're likened to men. Sometimes they would take on a body. So here, the job of this angel is to roll the stone away. And then the second thing is he's going to speak to Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. So he needs a body to do this, basically. So he rolls the stone. He descends from heaven, came, rolled back the stone from the door, set upon it. Verse 3, his countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. So, again, they talk about what he looks like. His countenance is as lightning, his raiment white as snow. Well, when we saw in Psalm 104, and we saw that the angels, he made his angels spirits, we also saw that, verse 2, that God himself covers himself with light as with a garment. And apparently that's what this angel looked like. He had light as with a garment because his countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. Because he has this clothing of light, then the keepers did shake and became as dead men. So he looked like a glorified man with this covering of light. He looked like God. And then the angel had to tell the women, don't fear, fear not ye. So an angel is a spirit, but it will take on a body if it needs to, like in Genesis 19 or like here in Matthew 28. When it does, it takes on the body of a man. In Genesis 19, they just look like ordinary men. So the men of Sodom weren't afraid of them. But here, he takes on this clothing of light. And so the keepers shook, and the Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were also afraid. So angels, basically, they're spirits. If they have a body, they are like a man. They are always described in the masculine. Here in the angel of the Lord, it's he. Gabriel and Michael, those are he's. They're never described as she. And so they look just like ordinary men, except if they take on a clothing of light, then they look like frightening men. So, this common thing about them looking like women and having wings, that may have to do with Satan. Were you going to say something?
Yeah, I was going to ask if that was more of a Catholic theme or if it was more Satan trying to get people to worship.
Yeah, Satan. Satan is in love with himself more than any person. He is the epitome of pride. And he, if you look over in Ezekiel 28, now remember we read earlier about the cherubim. And what a cherubim is, they have four wings, they have four faces. One of the faces is of an ox. And here you've got in Ezekiel 28, and verse 14, this is about Satan. And it says, thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. So Satan was not a special, I mean, he's a special creation and then he got a special job. But God created in heaven, he created seraphims, cherubims, and angels. And Satan was a cherub. He was special and he is the anointed cherub that covereth. And I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee. By the multitude of thy merchandise they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God. So he's not talking about a man here. Somebody's actually in the mountain of God who is perfect, and then he sinned. And it says, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. So thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings that they may behold thee. I notice he was corrupt. His heart was lifted up because of his beauty. So when you think of beauty and God's creation, usually the woman is considered the most beautiful of all of God's creation. And here God created a cherub that has four wings. And it's very beautiful. So Satan was a cherub, beautiful, with four wings. So you would think that if you want an image of Satan, somebody maybe looks like a woman, because that's a beautiful creation. I mean, he's in the masculine. It's not a feminine. Never referred to as she. Not saying Satan is a woman. I'm saying that he's got great beauty, and women are considered to be more beautiful creatures than men. Yes?
Well, I was going to say, for humans, women are, out of men and women, women are more beautiful. But if you notice in animals, say like birds, the male is more beautiful than the girl.
Usually, yes.
Because you got like a red bird. He is just like, you know, vibrant red and he's real, you know, pretty. And she is like this dull looking brown bird, which you would think it would be the opposite because it should be, you know, women are more beautiful than the men in humans, but in nature, it's usually the opposite.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And another thing is the reason it's, you would say, well, we think of angels as having two wings. People don't really think of cherubim. The reason is because Satan's goal is not for you to think of him as a cherub, but for him, for you to think of him as an angel. Look at 2 Corinthians 11. 2 Corinthians 11. Verse 13, talking about Christian pastors, basically, people who proclaim God but are really teaching false doctrine. It says, "For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light." He transforms himself into an angel of light. That's why I like Touched by an Angel. Whenever they showed that, they'd show this woman who would have a bright light behind her. And they had men angels too, but mostly it was, you think of Monica, I think her name was.
Yeah.
Roma Downey.
Roma Downey.
Mm-hmm. And she'd have this, she's a woman with the long hair and the beautiful light behind her. Well, Satan has transformed himself into an angel of light. So if he's a cherub and he has wings, he makes you think, and he wants to be an angel, then he makes you think that angels have wings, that they are, Satan is very beautiful, so he makes, you know, women is the creation that's more beautiful than men, so he makes you think he's a woman with the long flowing hair. So really the typical view of an angel is an unbiblical view, and it's what Satan wants you to think of himself as. Because if he's the guy with the pitchfork and red and the crooked tail and all that, you're not going to follow him. But if he's transformed himself into an angel of light, something of beauty, then you end up following him. And it's interesting, you're in 2 Corinthians 11. Go over to Galatians 1. Just a couple pages over in your Bible. And verse 8. "But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed." Well, who's preaching a false gospel? They're the false apostles, the false ministers of Satan, 2 Corinthians 11. But he mentions, or an angel. And Satan has transformed himself into an angel of light. I mean, you don't see angels coming out of the sky and preaching the gospel to you. But if his minister, Satan's ministers are pastors, they preach a false gospel, and Satan has transformed himself into an angel of light, then he says, maybe an angel from heaven preaches this gospel. So anyway, the typical view of an angel is Satan wanting you to think, and an angel, usually people, in fact, look over in Colossians 2. Verse 18, "Let no man beguile you of your reward and a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels." Why would you worship angels? Because they're very beautiful creatures with the wings and the light. They don't really have wings. They're not feminine. They don't have the light. They don't have the long flowing hair that we know of. But here they are worshiping angels. Satan wants people to worship him. He says, "I will be like the Most High God. I will sit upon the throne. People will worship me." So he creates in men's minds, he knows fallen man, and he says, "I'm going to create an image that is the most beautiful they can create. And I know the most beautiful creation of God is the woman. And so I will create a woman, but it will be much more beautiful because it will be lightened. The angel be like a light. And it'll be like an angel." We saw the angel in Matthew 28 had that white raiment. They were afraid, you know, with the bright light. So we're going to have a bright light, angel of light. We're going to have the two wings, so you know it's not just a man. You know, one of the great things that men want to do is fly. You know, they spent thousands of years before they came up with that airplane. And people will always want to, you know, be able to fly and get around like that. So we're going to have wings. we're going to have look like a man or look like a woman, because that's God's beautiful, most beautiful creature, but we're going to make it even more beautiful than that. And Satan, being perfect in beauty, now he's a cherub, so he has the four faces and doesn't look like that, but he knows that people will be attracted more so to a woman with the long flowing hair and the bright light and the two wings, more so than they will with a cherub with four wings and four faces that's an ox, an eagle, a lion, and a man. So he transforms himself from being a cherub into an angel of light. So then we see Colossians 2:18, worshiping of angels. People worship angels, and if they worship that image, and Satan has transformed himself into that image, then it's really the worship of Satan. So that's why angels look like that, because Satan has transformed himself into what he knows that men will think is the most beautiful creature, and then they're more likely to worship that, and then he'll get the worship as an angel of light, basically. Okay, so heaven consists of those three things: seraphims, cherubim, and angels. We know angels are spirits who look like men. They do not have wings. They're ministering spirits. Also in heaven, there are stories in heaven. Amos 9. Verse 6. So you could think of heaven as sort of like a skyscraper. I don't know how many stories there are. It doesn't say. But you know that it's if the New Jerusalem is 1,500 miles square, it goes up 1,500 miles. Of course, that's on earth. I understand that. But you would think heaven would be not unlike that. If you have the capacity to move around and fly and you don't have to worry about being stuck to the earth in heaven, then you don't just build a cross. Like in the U.S., you're going to build something. You got to go out to land and you build, you know, west or east or north or south. You can also go up. So it says in Amos 9:6, it is he, talking about God, that buildeth his stories in the heaven and hath founded his troop in the earth.
Isn't there something in Revelation that, I don't know if it's story, if it's like levels, when it mentions each stone, and then it says there's a gate. Is that levels, like stories, or is that just...
Now, you're talking about the New Jerusalem, and that has 12 gates, and each gate represents the tribe of Israel.
So it's not like stacked on top of each other like a story. It's just level.
It appears to be level, yes.
Okay.
It's very high up. But it's appears to be level, yeah.
Oh, okay.
So we saw in your outline that there are stories in heaven. The next thing I wanted you to see, that Satan is a cherub. We just read that, Ezekiel 28. And so now what we want to talk about is what happened in heaven. So now we know the structure. There's God, seraphim, cherubim, angels. There are stories in heaven. We know that Satan is a cherub. There was a rebellion that took place in heaven before man fell on earth. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Satan rebelled against God, wanted to be like the Most High God himself. And then he came down to earth and he got Adam and Eve to sin so he could try to take over the earth. So the rebellion happened in heaven first. Look in Isaiah 14. We already read Ezekiel 28. We saw there was iniquity found in him. So he rebelled. Isaiah 14 tells you what he was thinking about, what he wanted to do, his plan. Verse 12, Isaiah 14, 12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? That was his name when he was created as a cherub. His name was Lucifer. And then when he fell, God changes his name to Satan, which means deceiver. The word Lucifer means son of the morning. We're told that here. So he changes from being son of the morning to the deceiver. So Lucifer, son of the morning, how art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. So you can see his plan, it was a rebellion first in heaven. He says, I'm going to take over. God created the heaven and the earth, and I'm going to overthrow God and sit on his throne, and I will be over heaven and earth. So first thing he's going to do, or he wants to do, is ascend into heaven. He wants to take over the heaven first. So I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. That would be the angels. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation and the sides of the north. That's where God dwells. That's his throne there on the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the cloud. I will be like the Most High. According to Genesis 14, verse 19, the Most High God, the definition of that term, is the possessor of the heaven and earth. I'll read that to you. Genesis 14, verse 19. And he blessed him and said, blessed be Abram of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. So the Most High God is the possessor of heaven and earth. So when Satan says he's going to be like the Most High, that means Satan declares that he is going to possess the heaven and the earth, those two realms that God created. But the first thing he's going to do, according to verse 13 of Isaiah 14, or that he wants to do, he's not going to do it, he wants to do it, is he says, I will ascend into heaven. So his first plan was to get to heaven. His second plan is to get the earth. So the rebellion starts in heaven. And then verse 15, God says, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. So he says, I'm going to ascend to heaven, and I will sit in the sides of the north. And God says, you're not going to sit in the sides of the north, you're going to sit in the sides of the pit. So there's iniquity found in him. He's very prideful. He was that anointed cherub that covereth. He covereth the throne of God, which is a very beautiful place. And he saw himself and says, well, I'm beautiful. Why should I cover the throne? I should sit on the throne. And so I'm going to leave this position of covering the throne and protecting it, and I'm going to overthrow the throne too. And so that's when iniquity is found in him because of his pride, that he decides he's going to do all these things in rebellion against God. So then what he does then, remember he's in heaven, so he's going to try to ascend. His first statement, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. The stars of God being angels. So in order for him to be above the angels, he needs to get some of the angels to follow him. And so when he rebels and comes up with this plan of what he's going to do, he convinces one-third of the angels to take his side. And basically say, yes, we believe you will overthrow God and we will want to be on your side. We will be your angels. And so one-third of the angels rebel with him. And that's from Revelation chapter 12. Yes?
Real quick on Isaiah 14, 16. Uh-huh. You're talking about angels being a man. It states, Isaiah 14, 16, they that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble, that did shake kingdoms? So is that, even though Satan was a cherub when he was in heaven, when he fell, he became more of a, I mean, I know he's a spirit, but I mean.
He is a cherub. God created him as a cherub, so that's what he is.
So is he still a cherub?
Yes, he's still a cherub today.
Well, then why does it say
But then, remember, he says, over in 2 Corinthians 11, that Satan has transformed himself into an angel of light. He wants, like I say, he's not going to be the red-faced guy with the tail and the pitchfork. What he did is he created that as an image of somebody bad. He wants you to worship him. In Luke 4, when Jesus was tempted by Satan, he said, I will give you all these kingdoms if you will bow down and worship me. Satan's ultimate goal is to be worshipped because he wants to be like the Most High. He wants to possess heaven and earth. And if everybody worships him, then he is God, I mean, that's what a God is, somebody who's worshipped. So if everybody worships him and heaven and an earth, then he possesses heaven and earth and they all worship him. And he figures that it's a lot more likely that someone will, that people will worship an angel of light than a cherub. So when Paul says he's transformed himself into an angel of light, he doesn't have the capacity to change who he is because God created him as a cherub. So that's who he is. But what he does is he makes himself look like an angel of light, knowing that's what people will worship. Then he creates this image of the red guy with the pitchfork and the tail so that you think that's the devil. So then you'll look at the angel of light and say, that's not the devil. That's really what God looks like because it's so beautiful. And so that's why it says it, because it's not God. In Isaiah 14, 16, this isn't God speaking. It says, they that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble, that did shake kingdoms? So they're thinking of him as a man.
Okay.
Yeah. But he's not actually a man. He's not actually an angel of light. He's a cherub. But he looks like an angel of light. He transforms himself into that so that people will worship him. And then he creates that red guy as, oh, that's the devil. Revelation 12, to see the rebellion in heaven. First look in verse 9. It says, the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So from that verse, we see that Satan does have angels, ones that rebelled against him. We see he's called the dragon, great dragon. He's called the serpent. He's called the devil, and he's called Satan. So with that in mind, look in verse 3, Revelation 12, 3. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon. So we know from verse 9 that we're looking at Satan right here. A great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven. Now we saw the stars in Isaiah 14, and I mentioned that they are angels of God. So if his tail draws this third part of the stars of heaven, that means a third of the angels rebel with him. And we know those are angels because of what verse 9 says, that his angels were cast out with him. So when it says stars of God, or in this case stars of heaven, it's a reference to angels. He got one third of the angels to rebel with him. So he came up with this plan to overthrow God and become God himself. He shared that with the angels, and one third of them says, yes, you'll be successful. I will side with you. So there was a rebellion in heaven. Satan rebelled and took one third of the angels with him. Go over to Psalm 78. I just want you to see, because when angels are mentioned, people think of them as good. People don't think of angels as being bad. When they become fallen angels, the Bible usually refers to them as devils. In other words, since they sided with the devil, Satan, then they are called devils as well. But recognize that the term angel can refer to fallen angels or part of Satan. And so that's why I bring up this term here in Psalm 78, verse 49. Psalm 78, 49. He cast upon them the fierceness of his anger, wrath, and indignation, and trouble by sending evil angels among them. I recognize we're out of context there. This is about Israel. But I just wanted you to see that there are evil angels. I wrote on your outline, therefore there are now evil angels. So all angels are good when God created them, but the third of the angels that rebel with Satan are evil angels. And you may think, well, he didn't do that good of a job because only a third of the angels rebel, which means two-thirds of the angels are still with God. And that's true. But he did do a good job in that most of the angels that rebelled came from high-ranking positions. If you look over in Let's say, for example, Ephesians 1. Remember we read about there being stories in heaven over in Amos 9? Those stories can also relate to the governmental structure that God has levels of rule in the government of heaven. You see in Ephesians 1, verse 21, you see some of these mentioned. Verse 20, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. So we're talking about heaven now, heavenly places. Far above all principality, that's one level of government, and power, that's another level, and might, there's another level, and dominion, there's another level, and every name that is named, that's another level. Look at Colossians 1. You can see another level mentioned here that's not mentioned in Ephesians 1. Colossians 1, verse 16. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones, so that's another level not mentioned in Ephesians 1, or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. So there are all these different levels. If you're a throne or a dominion, you're higher than in every name that is named, or a principality, or a might, or a power. And so the angels are in these different levels of government in heaven. Satan, if he's the anointed cherub that covereth and he's over the throne, he's a very high-ranking, he's not an angel, but a very high-ranking cherub in heaven. And when he gets one-third of the angels to rebel with him, apparently, most of those angels were in the high-ranking positions, not in the low-ranking. We get that if we go over to Daniel chapter 10. Daniel chapter 10. In Daniel 9, Daniel is given a vision of what will take place at the end with the remainder of Israel's history, the last 490 years of Israel's history. Well, he didn't understand it. So in Daniel 10:1, it says, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a thing was revealed unto Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar. And the thing was true, but the time appointed was long. And he understood the thing and had understanding of the vision. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. So he's mourning 3 weeks there, and he's praying. And then finally, after 3 weeks, verse 5, then I lift up mine eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen. That actually ends up being the angel Gabriel. He's not given by name in chapter 10, I don't think. But he is mentioned in some other place. But anyway, but notice it says a certain man. Again, man being likened to an angel being likened to a man. He's clothed in linen. You see his verse 6 talks about his appearance. And then, finally, verse 11, he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto thee, and stand upright, for unto thee am I now sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. Then said he unto me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. So we saw from verse 2 that he was in mourning for 3 full weeks. Well, the angel Gabriel says that from the first day that he started this mourning process, Gabriel was sent to Daniel to comfort him and give him understanding. But there's a problem. Verse 13, but the prince of the kingdom of Persia, so that would be an evil angel of Satan's kingdom, withstood me 1 and 20 days. That's 3 weeks. Daniel was in mourning for 3 weeks. God says, immediately when Daniel begins praying, God says, okay, Gabriel, go comfort my servant Daniel. But yet Daniel mourns 3 weeks because the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood him 1 and 20 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. It took 21 days before Michael came to help Gabriel. And then, so then he talks to him, and then in verse 20, Gabriel says, "Then said he, Knowest thou wherefore I came unto thee? And now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia, and when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come." So he fought with the prince of Persia going to Daniel, and the prince of Persia was powerful enough to keep Gabriel from getting to Daniel for 3 full weeks. And it took Michael to help out Gabriel to get by the prince of Persia. Well, why did it take Michael so long? Evidently, Michael was fighting his own battles for 3 weeks before he could get freed up to go to help out Gabriel against the prince of Persia. And then when Gabriel is leaving Daniel, Gabriel says that when he leaves, he's going to fight the prince of Persia again. And then when he goes forth, finally gets from the prince of Persia, then the prince of Grecia is going to fight against him. What that shows, in other words, if 2/3 of the angels stayed with God and 1/3 of the angels was Satan, then God's army of angels outnumbers Satan's army of angels 2-1. And so if God sends Gabriel to go tell Daniel, it shouldn't take 3 weeks. The reason of this fight and this struggle, and why Michael is the only one mentioned in the Bible called the archangel. If you look over in the book of Jude, I'll show you this. Jude verse 9. This is where Michael, it says, "Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, The Lord rebuke thee." So Michael is the archangel, the only one called that. So apparently, of all the angels, with the exception, of course, Jesus Christ, he is over all the angels. He's the archangel. And he stayed true to God. But yet, and God's army of angels outnumbers Satan's army 2-1, but yet, the devil puts up a formidable fight in that it takes Gabriel 3 weeks to get to Daniel. And because he's got to wait for Michael, well, Michael must be busy in war himself for 3 weeks before he can get to Gabriel to help him out. And then when Gabriel leaves, he's got to fight the prince of Persia and the prince of Grecia. So what that shows is that of the third of the angels that rebelled against God and sided with Satan, most of them were high-ranking angels. And the reason only Michael and Gabriel are named the only two angels given by name in the Bible are Michael and Gabriel, is that of the high-ranking angels, those that are in thrones or dominions, you know, those different levels, and they're at the top ranks, apparently, Michael and Gabriel are the only ones of those higher-ranking angels that stayed true to God. So although only a third of the angels rebel with Satan, of the high-ranking positions, more than a third, almost all, except for Michael and Gabriel, rebelled with Satan. And you can see that in Daniel 10, verse 21. He says, "But I will show thee that which is noted in the scripture of truth, and there is none that holdeth with me in these things but Michael your prince." So when it comes to those high-ranking angels, Gabriel says, it's only me and Michael who are holding in the scripture of truth. We're the only good angels in those high-ranking positions. So when I came to give you the truth, Daniel, it took 3 weeks because there are a lot of high-ranking angels that kept me from getting there. And when I leave you, I got to go back and fight those high-ranking angels again. So even though Satan only had a third of the angels rebel with him, most of the high-ranking angels followed Satan in the rebellion. And so that's why if you go to Job chapter 15, Job chapter 15, verse 15, Job 15, 15, it says, "Behold, he," that's God there, "behold, God putteth no trust in his saints, yea, the heavens are not clean in his sight." So when it says, "In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth," then the focus in the next verse is the earth. It says, "And the earth," Genesis 1, 2. It says, "And the earth was without form and void." And God focuses on the earth. And so because of that, and that's where we live, is on the earth, Christians have this idea that everything is hunky-dory up there in heaven and everything is fine. It's just we're all messed up on the earth. But the truth of the matter is that it says the heavens are not clean in his sight. There was a rebellion in heaven, and it's a very large rebellion in that Satan and his angels are a lot of the high-ranking authorities in heaven are on Satan's side. And so there's war up there and things that are delayed in what God brings about because of those high-ranking angels beating on Satan's side. And it's not that they're more powerful. I mean, Michael is the archangel. Jesus Christ is called the angel of the Lord. He can overthrow them all. So it's not that Satan and his forces are stopping God. God knew what would happen. He knew he would bring his plan to come to pass, even though Satan and those angels rebelled against him. But the point is that God knew what would happen, and his plan will come to pass. But the point is that there is still great opposition in heaven. Also, you're in Job. Look at Job chapter 1.
While we're turning, can I ask, is that
sure
where spiritual warfare comes from? As far as...
spiritual warfare, good idea. Look in Ephesians 6.
Sorry, everybody. Job, we're going to Ephesians.
No, it's good because we mentioned the levels of government in heaven. The thrones, the dominions, the principalities, the powers. Ephesians 6:12 says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." So it's a spiritual battle, but you can see we're wrestling against principalities and powers. That's some of those structure in the heavenly places. Well, if we're children of God and we're wrestling against them, then we're wrestling against Satan's forces. The rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places. Those things show that there was a rebellion in heaven, that it's ongoing, that Satan still has power in those areas. Now, the cross defeated that. If you go over to Colossians 2, on the cross, verse 15, it says, Colossians 2:15, that Christ spoiled principalities and powers. He made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it, meaning in the cross. So he triumphed over Satan's forces through the cross. God wins the battle. God wins the victory. Triumphed over them. And so then you may ask, well, if he won the victory over them, why are we fighting against them? Didn't he win? Why is there still spiritual wickedness after the cross? The answer is because God has not reconciled heaven and earth back to himself yet. Satan is still the god of this world. Go over to 1 Corinthians 15. And we're just going to look at a few verses. Look at verse 26. "The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death." That's future. Death is going to be destroyed in the future. So that means that although God has won the victory through the cross of Christ and spoiled principalities and powers, they are still operating in those positions and have a power and authority. We wrestle against them because death hasn't been destroyed yet. Look down in verse 1 Corinthians 15. You're there, verse 26. Verse 27, for he hath put all things under his feet, under Christ's feet there. But when he said, so he put all things under his feet. Okay, now let's look at Hebrews chapter 2. Look at Hebrews chapter 2. Verse 8, thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. But then notice what it says, for in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. So he wins the victory. He destroys principalities and powers, making an open show of them. But then it says, but now we see not yet all things put under him. So Christ wins the victory, principalities and powers. But not yet do we see all things put under him. The reason is because death has not been destroyed yet. People still die. Back in 1 Corinthians 15 now, verse 54, so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, that goes, go back to verse 51. 1 Corinthians 15, 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. So this is talking about the rapture of the body of Christ. It's still future. And until that happens, the dead has not been raised incorruptible. So if the dead has not been raised incorruptible, death hasn't been destroyed yet. So verse 54, so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption at the rapture, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then, that's future tense, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ destroyed death, triumphing over principalities and powers on the cross. But the victory is not given to us until the rapture. That's when death is swallowed up in victory. That's when the last enemy, death, is destroyed. So even though God won the victory with Christ on the cross, principalities and powers and Satan and his forces are still operating in those positions of authority because death has not been destroyed for us until we rise up from the grave at the rapture. So then if you go back to Job 1 and verse 6, you can see it says, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. The sons of God, they're another term for the angels. Notice Satan is separated from them because he's not an angel, he's a cherub. And the Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? So Satan is the god of this world according to 2 Corinthians 4:4. Sure, he's been defeated after the cross, but death is not destroyed yet, and Satan has that power of darkness or the power of death. And so until death is swallowed up in victory at the rapture for us and at the second coming for Israel, then Satan continues to be the god of this world. He still has to report to the Lord, as he does here. He presents himself to the Lord. The evil angels and Satan present themselves to the Lord because Satan is still sitting, the Lord God is still sitting on the sides of the north. He's still on the throne. But Satan has authority in those positions of government, and he's got the high-ranking angels with him. And then Satan says in verse 11, put forth thine hand now and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. And verse 12, and the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power, only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan still has to report to God, and God still has the authority. He says, okay, you can do what you want to, Job, but upon him do not put forth your hand. So it shows the heavens are unclean in his sight, and even though Christ won the victory over principalities and powers on the cross, death is still reigning until the rapture. And so since death is still reigning, Satan and his forces are still in those positions. And so we still wrestle against principalities and powers, against spiritual darkness. But at the same time, God is still over all because he is still sitting on the throne in the sides of the north. Did that cover it good?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's quit there. That we've covered heaven. But I wanted you to see, because people think, well, the earth is bad, but the heaven is good. And you see in heaven there is still a rebellion. Satan and his forces, a third of the angels, and most of the high-ranking angels are there. And we're still wrestling against those principalities and powers, against spiritual darkness in high places, in those high heavenly positions. Satan and his forces are still there and will continue to be there until the rapture. So that's the state of heaven. And the next time we're going to see that Satan is also very successful in getting the dominion of the earth, or I should say, becoming the god of this world. Let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we trust you and have faith in your word, that even though we see Satan as the prince of the power of the air, and we wrestle against him and his forces, we see that you have won the victory, that death is swallowed up in victory through the cross of Christ, that you spoiled and triumphed over those principalities and powers, and that if we just trust in you and wait for that time when you are going to destroy that last enemy, death, we will rule and reign with you forever. So help us to have walk by the faith in your word and not by sight, so that we will not succumb to the lust of the flesh, but that we will allow you to teach us the things of your word and allow Christ to live in us so that others may be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, thanks for joining us for heaven. And next time, we will cover what happened on earth, the creation of that and the rebellion there. So join us next time.